Welcome back from that short break, and of course, thank you very much for keeping it live here with us on Abin today. Before we went in for a break, I did mention lined up interviews regarding entertainment and conservation. Now, this morning, we're going to begin our kachai with conservation. Yes, when we talk about conservation, we're looking at our environment, we're looking at our animals, we're looking at everything that defines us as Uganda, the Pearl of Africa. Now, this morning, I'm going to be talking to two gentlemen. They're all conservationists, but this time around, one also doubles as a filmmaker. But on my left is a very renowned friend of mine, conservationist Shaban Senyanga. Good morning to you.
Good morning, Derek. How are you?
Very fantastic. Or you prefer the other one, Assalamu Alaikum.
That's even better.
How have you been? What you been up to?
Been well. Mm. The gentleman over there has been keeping me very busy.
Okay.
With the campaign that we're working on.
All right.
In Uganda.
Okay.
Which is Sides of a Horn, really bringing the conversation to the people here.
All right, we'll get into those details later on. On my right, I have Toby Wasco, who's a filmmaker. Good morning to you, Toby.
Good morning.
How have you been?
Incredible. We got to Uganda about 24 hours ago,
really?
And it's been an awesome experience so far.
Did you have enough rest before you go to the show?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Is it your first time to be around?
Yeah, in Uganda, yeah.
How do you find the environment?
It's been so welcoming. The mm-hmm. people are so kind, and it's just been an incredible experience. The traffic is intense,
crazy.
But the people are amazing.
How about the food? You're the first person not to mention food.
The food. Yeah. I had a Rolex for breakfast.
Definitely. Shaban had to give you that.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that was it.
That was it. Just okay. Lots of Rolexes.
Okay, interesting. Let's come back to the reason why you're here. Sides of a Horn. First, tell me, you are the brains as far as, you know, making this film is concerned. Give me the synopsis of this film.
It looks at the rhino poaching war mm-hmm. That's happening in a lot of African countries across the continent. Mm. And it's a fictional film based on actual events through a lot of research and interviews with people in communities that looks at two brothers-in-law, mm-hmm. both from the same community, who end up on opposite sides of the poaching war. So one becomes a ranger and one becomes a poacher. Mm, mm. And it's sort of a character study of how can two people from the same place, the same circumstances, and even the same family
okay.
end up on opposite sides.
All right. Okay, I want us to get into the long bit of the show of the whole film. It's going to be later on. Shaban, when you look at the conservation story, you know, this is not the first time we're talking about conservation in
right.
Uganda. It has yeah. been evolving over time. And now we're even getting into film. This is
right.
a new venture, I must say.
Yeah.
Do you actually feel like we are close to conserving our environment as far as bettering it for the future is concerned?
I think Uganda is definitely taking huge strides. You know, mm. if, you know, based off of just rhinos as an example, we had rhinos going extinct in 1983.
Mm.
That is in Marksian Falls and Kidepo. But we are seeing a trajectory. We are now at 30. So it really shows a growth and concern and more commitments towards protecting our endangered species.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, speaking more about what we're here about, we cannot rest now and say we're on a trajectory and ignore the aspect of creating awareness.
Because mm-hmm.
it's very important. And even when you're creating awareness, it's not really about, say, filmmakers like Toby, who is trying to create awareness, or myself doing awareness as well. But it really goes beyond, you know, the people who are doing the creative. It's really everyone.
Mm, mm, mm.
That's reminding people that everyone has a role to play in conserving our nature. It's not up to Uganda Wildlife Authority or Rhino Fund Uganda. It's really a collective responsibility where each one of us plays a role. And what we're here to do is really communicate what each one can do to make sure that we don't have our animals going extinct.
As someone who has interacted with different communities, different
right.
people from different backgrounds
right.
in Uganda, to be very particular, do you think that people actually even, you know, give two flying doves about conserving the environment? Or, you know, given the space of, you know, overpopulation and
right.
people are looking into land for farming, land for settlement, they're actually not caring about conserving the environment?
Right, and you raise a very important issue. Human-wildlife conflicts are arguably the biggest threat that we have to conservation.
Mm-hmm.
And the argument of humans, who do you give more priority? Is it humans
yes.
or is it the animals?
The animals,
it's
yes.
a conversation that is going on and about, but it's down to basic human survival.
Mm-hmm.
Even animals, it's down to their survival. If you tell a community member around the peripheries of the national park to conserve these animals
mm.
and they're not getting clear benefits as to why they should conserve the animals,
mm-hmm.
if they don't have the assurance that they're going to even survive or get a meal the next day, if they're not going to send their kids to school, if they don't have proper infrastructure, health facilities, conserving a rhino or any other animal is going to be the least of their worries.
Okay.
So moving forward, and what we want to have more conversations around is, how do you tell people to protect the animals at the same time giving them alternative livelihoods for them to survive? If we don't have that conversation, it's going to go down to basic human survival.
I want you to give us details of that conservation, because according to me, it's a conflicting loyalty. I mean, you have humans, you have animals. At the end of the day, you need both of them to coexist with each other. But I want you to hold into that thought. Coming back to you, Toby, what exactly triggered you to get into venturing of film as far as communicating the message of conservation is concerned?
So I was actually traveling in South Africa, and I met a game ranger who started telling me about the poaching war and how is this multi-billion dollar illegal wildlife trade on a global scale. And then I started going to some communities in South Africa, and I saw that, you know, a poacher and an anti-poacher can come from the same community. And when I did some research, nobody was talking about that. You know, there's a lot of documentaries, there's a lot of news coverage about this global illegal wildlife trade, but nobody's talking about the communities and how do we make it beneficial for the communities to protect the wildlife instead of poaching it. And so I just started writing and interviewing, and the film is scripted, it's fictional, but it's based on a lot of research and interviewing people and taking that dialogue and putting it into the mouths of the characters. And so it's been about a two-year process. And bringing it here to Uganda is, you know, we've traveled around the world with it. We've taken it to Asia, where the demand for rhino horn is, and reached millions of people. We've translated it into 12 languages, released it online all over the world. But this tour in Uganda is the first time that we're really bringing it to the African continent and having conversations with communities. And
So Uganda is the first country in the African continent where you're going to be showing this.
Yes,
despite the fact that the story is driven from South Africa, you're deciding to show this for the very first time in Africa, in Uganda.
And that is because of Shaban.
Okay.
And how. I mean, he's been incredible. He's set up this whole tour, and he's just been so passionate about the film. And he's really become kind of the African voice for Sides of a Horn. And so, yeah, it's because of him that all of this is happening and the reason that we're bringing it to Uganda.
Quite interesting. Now, given that as a background, I want us to, you know, to get into a conversation I was having with Shaban, coexistence of the human beings together with the animals. Do you see this happening? You know, given the different factors that people are going to raise as far as, you know, encroaching on the environment is concerned, do you think this is actually possible and viable to be achieved in even a couple of years from now?
Yes. And there's already examples of it happening. Even, you know, yesterday we were speaking with someone from the Rhino Sanctuary here in Uganda, and what they're doing is exactly what needs to be done. They're finding ways to make it beneficial for the local people to get involved in protecting the wildlife. And once the community living next to the park has bought into the concept of conservation, then that's your barrier. Those are the people who are right there, and if they're going to protect it, then it's going to work.
It's going to work, all right. Shaban, what are some of the things that you have on your fingertips that you're sure these ones are going to work as far as, you know, this coexistence is working?
Right. One, the Uganda Wildlife Authority has already created a mechanism where they channel 20% of park entrance fees to the local communities. They don't pass it to individuals, they pass it to groups. So if there's a group that can work on a project or, you know, invest it in something that can generate more income, they're already doing that. There's a women group around Queen Elizabeth that makes paper from elephant dung. So instead of them chasing the elephants away, they're able to channel that. And from the paper, they can make crafts, they can make notebooks and all these other things, and they sell them to tourists. Rhino Fund Uganda, like Toby highlighted, we spoke to Vincent Opiene, who is one of the board members. And what they're doing is they take the communities in to graze within the national park, whether the sanctuary. And so that creates a coexistence between the communities and the park authorities. And what that does is, when you bring in the pastoralists to graze, they've given them an ultimatum and say, if anything happens inside this sanctuary and you are within it and you're not reporting these incidences, you're going to be kicked out of, you know. So they've already signed those agreements. They're taking on you know, people from war-torn areas or the fishermen that have now lost all their boats, they're bringing them in, and it's going to happen right at the end of the project on the 28th. They're going to be taken to the sanctuary. So they train them, they give them job opportunities, and then they're recruited as, you know, conservation rangers. There's also a women group that has been taking in to provide food to all the staff and all the guests that come to the sanctuary. So there's so many avenues that can be explored, really.
And even just the beauty about it is that they're practical.
Yes.
They can definitely work.
Exactly.
All right. Maybe the conversation story could definitely yield 100% potential as far as conserving the environment is concerned. Toby, back to you, but this time around as a filmmaker, what do you think on the levels of impact this movie is going to have on the communities?
I think it's down to, you know, when we were talking to some people yesterday, they were saying that, you know, a lot of Ugandan communities, they don't have the radio, they don't have TV. So it's about physically bringing the film to them and having conversations. And I think that's the next step in this launch of the film. We've we've been able to do really, really well in Asia, curbing the on the demand side, showing people who consume rhino horn and other wildlife products what that consumption, the effect that it has on the other side of the world in Africa, and the war that it's creating. And so now it's really about bringing it to local communities who can't necessarily watch it on YouTube or and can't really, you know, watch this interview or hear about it on the radio.
Is it going to be distributed, you know, countrywide? Can I access it in a library or?
We're working on it, but first it's about translating it into more languages. Because I know there's a lot of languages here in Uganda.
Oh, so you're thinking about translating into different tribal languages?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, that's an interesting one.
And it's easy to do and it's cheap, and that's definitely a next step.
Okay.
And then it's figuring out how to get it to those different communities.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Talking about the next step before we get to wrap up, we understand tomorrow we are having the main screening, which is going to be happening in Munyonyo. Now tell me about the screening. Who wants to go first? Is it Toby? Is it Shaban?
Shaban organized the whole thing, so he can take it away.
Shaban, tell me about the screening that is happening tomorrow.
So what we wanted to do really is explore different avenues of how you create conservation awareness.
Mm.
And conservation awareness has never been seen as something high profile, as something classy, as something that can pull crowds. And we wanted it to be the first high profile conservation event.
Okay.
In Uganda, and what better way to do it than a movie premiere? So we have a red carpet from seven, from 5 to 7 for the bougie people. You'll have to dress up. Please come and stay the red carpet.
I got my card. Thank you very
awesome. Much. Awesome. Then we're going to be doing a reception. Besides just being a premiere, we want to give people space to talk and create opportunities on how they can move forward with this conversation, not only to create awareness, but exploring different partnerships of what they can do even after the film. So we want to give people that space. And also something interesting about the reception, we are going to be, courtesy of Rhino Fund Uganda, we're going to be doing a photo exhibition of the rhino story in Uganda.
Okay.
So we want to make it really intentional.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the movie premiere, I don't want to give anything away, but we have a huge, amazing list of invites that we have. It was invite only, so we had to select at the crowd. So if you didn't get an invite, no offense, but you
are you looking to the camera and tell them I got the invite.
Yeah, so we want to give people a cinematic experience to really just see the amazing work that Toby has been doing and what we are doing at our front here in Uganda. And then at the end, we're going to be having a panel discussion with top conservation persons and organizations in Uganda to see what more we can do on the front here in Uganda.
All right.
And of course, if people feel the need, we might not have an after party. We'll see how it goes.
That's Shaban's way of saying we're going to have an after party. Toby, as we do get to wrap up, what are your last words? I mean, it's your first time in Uganda, for the Ugandans out there and your fellow conservationists that probably haven't even rubbed shoulders with but are watching the show right about now.
I mean, what really grabbed me and made me make this film is the fact that rhinos have been around for 50 million years. And they could be 10 years away from extinction. And just getting that concept around our mind, 50 million to 10, it's scary, and it's symbolic of what's happening with a lot of other species and with our planet in general. And so just do everything that you can. You know, it's not just about rhinos, it's about every species and our entire planet. And, you know, Shaban, everything that he was saying, there's it takes all of us. It's not just the conservationists. It's not just the game rangers. Okay. Everyone can do something.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Toby and Shabana, conservationists, as far as you know, bettering our environment is concerned. Tomorrow it's going to be, of course, raining red carpet. And in case you've not been invited, well, one thing I can be sure of is that I've been invited. Willis has been invited. Tina has been invited. So all you need to do is just head over to our social media pages, and we'll keep you updated of how it's going to be going down. Sides of the horn, and we're remembering that conservation begins with you and I for the betterness of the future. Urban Today still goes ahead. We're going for a very short break, but our next interview is going to involve a lot of entertainment. And this time around, we're looking at the role of digital as far as artists and their music is concerned. And later on, of course, they'll be joining us for the Love Letter.